So I think we can go ahead and get started. I'm going to welcome you all today to the Data and Computational Science series. This is a provost funded series put on by UC Libraries Research and Data Service Team and the Office of Research, Research Technologies Unit. And we welcome Ashley Farley today for this conversation. I am recording this session, so just so you know, but I'm going to stop sharing my screen and turn it, the screen sharing over to Ashley. And while I'm doing that, I'm going to read her biography. Okay. So we are very happy to have Ashley Farley with us today. Over the past decade, Ashley has been in both academic and public libraries focused on digital inclusion and facilitating access to scholarly content. She completed her master's in library and information science through the University of Washington Information School. Ashley is a program officer of knowledge and research services at the Bill and Linda Gates Foundation. And in this capacity, she leads the foundation's open access policy, implementation, and associated initiatives. This includes leading the work of Gates Open Research, a transparent and revolutionary publishing platform. Other core activities involve supporting the strategic and operational aspects of the foundation's library. This work has sparked a passion for open access, believing that freely accessible knowledge has the power to improve and save lives. So Ashley, welcome.
Thank you. Can you see my screens all right? My slides?
I cannot. So let me see if I can pull it up. Can others? Okay, now I can see it, yeah.
Okay, great. Awesome. Thank you so much for the introduction and really appreciate the opportunity to come and speak with you today. So we're going to cover a lot today, and so I kind of wanted to give a high level kind of buckets of some of the things that we'll discuss. I'm going to kick it off with a disclaimer, just kind of set the context of my perspective and where I'm coming from, some ecosystem pain points, what I'm talking about, evidence-based publishing, a little bit about copyright, and then transitioning from kind of where the pain points are into the remedy and solutions, and then ending on some of the fair data work that we've been doing at the foundation. So I just want to start by saying that as the bio stated, I've been a librarian my whole career, so that's the perspective I come from. So not exactly a researcher, but definitely very interested in research dissemination, and really believe that knowledge can make people's lives better, and want to make sure everyone has equitable access to information. I want to acknowledge that I work at a very privileged institution, so the Gates Foundation definitely is a place of privilege, and we have a lot of money to be able to do things, and want to acknowledge not all funders, institutions, or researchers can do the same. And then also want to state that much of what follows are definitely generalizations. I often use the hashtag not all publishers. There are, and I will touch on like great players in the space, and I don't want to demean anyone's work at an individual level, but I think it's important for us to have more critical conversations in this space, and I think that will make the ecosystem a bit stronger. So some of the things I talk about today are not necessarily popular opinion, but they're just meant to, I think, further the conversation, and maybe I hope to frame it in a different way than what we've heard in the past. So we're going to start with the ecosystem pain points, the information overload space, a proliferation of policies, and then a little deep dive into some of the different business models around publishing. So right now we definitely, I think, are experiencing a lot of information overload, and I know that this is a topic that's discussed a lot in libraries and a lot in the research space of how do we stay up to date. Even in niche areas of research, it can be quite hard to stay on top of all the relevant research. It's estimated there's over 2 million articles published each year. And then we've been pitched quite a few solutions. Like, I think that there could be technological solutions to this to help people be able to wade through all the information. But strict copyright is making that very difficult. So we've seen some great test pilots on, abstracts, but that's so limited in kind of what those technologies can do to be able to produce meaningful synopses of the research. I will talk a little bit more about what I think causes that and how we can kind of address that. But I think the real issue here is that's also a cost burden the entire system as we keep generating more and more things that need to be peer reviewed and curated. So how do we combat that? Preprints are a really interesting, I think, point in the ecosystem from my perspective. The way that I see it, the preprints have really become a driving force for authors to make change in the system. I think typically, they came around as a way to kind of fix some of the traditional pain points in the publishing system. Mainly speed is a big one, and being able to kind of share your information more easily without having to wait for the whole peer review process, which can often take 6 months to a year or even longer. I've seen, even this year, papers being published that had started the publication process 3 years ago, which is, especially in the area that I work in, which is primarily global health and global development, that's a long time to share information that can be critical to public health or policy. So I see preprints as a way that, authors are like, we really need to fix this, and this is what we're going to do. I think originally publishers had pretty strict policies, and some still do, that wouldn't accept manuscripts that were in a preprint form. But I think that authors kept pushing and leveraging and using those preprint systems that it got to a point where publishers had to change their policies in order to remain competitive and relevant in this space. I think that's a really interesting way to look at it, an important message to learn of authors really advocating for what they need in this publishing ecosystem. So I see it as a workaround to the slow traditionally publishing models, but I do worry now that we are getting to a stage of where we're almost supporting two completely complementary systems. So especially from a funder perspective, we get a lot of requests to help fund things to, add more commenting or review or checks around preprints before they even make it to a specific journal. And I worry that that's going to overburden the system more. So it's interesting to see, how this may play out. But I do think it's opened an interesting opportunity for community peer review versus different technologies like PubHub. I'm continually impressed by the quality of peer review that I often see on Twitter and kind of the breakdown there, and find that, interesting in how researchers are motivated to help the community get things right, and will dispute things very critically, but I think professionally as well, on Twitter, which is pretty incredible to me. And we really do need improved linkages to other components. So it's still very hard to tell, where a preprint may have ended up. It's still, I think, kind of a manual process. So that's one thing that we've been thinking through is, how can we improve tracking of preprints into the final version of record. Although I will talk a bit later about kind of, I think the version of, we should get away from kind of thinking about the version of record as a one and done piece of research. So another component that I think really adds to the information overload is faulty metrics and perverse incentives. And this is something that comes up every time, we have discussions around scholarly communications. It's important for in the current state that researchers publish in certain journals. We know generally that impact factors is a faulty metric, that we shouldn't be using it, but there hasn't been a strong alternative. There hasn't been a huge shift away from that. And it just continually comes up that the academic career incentive is something that's a major obstacle to really reimagining the research ecosystem. But funders are signaling a shift. So, we've been DORA signatories for a while. That work has been developing. We've joined Coalition S and Plan S, which also supports DORA and the other manifestos that are really trying to shift this away from faulty metrics and changing how we evaluate researchers, which I think is really critical and could help us shift away from this publish or perish, where, we are maybe unnecessarily adding volume to the ecosystem. We've seen kind of a proliferation of what's called salami publishing. So, you know, we fund a research study, a study is done, most likely could be encapsulated in one or two articles, but instead it ends up being, you know, a journal supplement of 10 to 12 articles for various reasons. And some of them are very good, but other times, you know, we worry that we're going for more of the added citation and citation counts versus just disseminating the information. And so I think we really do need a behavior and cultural change. A technology component of the future of scholarly communications will be the easy part, but the, as with anything, having that cultural change is going to be really hard. But I think there's been a lot of progress over the last decade. And I think there's kind of a component of kind of a boogeyman or FUD, fear, uncertainty, and doubt, around the incentive system, because they oftentimes they aren't explicitly written down. The promotion, you know, tenure and review may not actually explicitly state these things, that you must publish in a certain journal or have a certain impact factor, but it can be very much part of the culture anyways. Or there are definitely examples where they are explicitly stated that you must publish in these journals in order to advance your career. There's been some interesting research done out of the Skolcom lab up in Canada that is has been collecting US and Canadian documents around promotion, review, and tenure, and tracking kind of what language is used. And I think there was only like one example out of hundreds that really kind of focused on openness and shifting from the closed culture to an open one. And we hope to see more shifts like that, but it's great to have at least more of a foundational understanding of what these incentives look like. And that moves us into a proliferation of policies. So all of this, again, is very intertwined. We're seeing more and more funders are adding strong mandates around openness and research output sharing, whether it's open data or managed data, which is great. And we see, you know, new funders now trying to collaborate more. So in the last 2 years, we joined the Coalition S, which is a global group, still very heavy in the European countries, but really we're trying to grow more. And part of that is we're trying to also work more collaboratively, because having so many different policies from so many different institutions makes it hard to have, you know, levers to add pressure to the publishers to change their policies, but also it creates extra burden on researchers and definitely staff as well to like work through those. And we see a shift in thinking, and this is, I think, really important, that funders are beginning to see that paying for like publication and infrastructure is a critical part of research. So really trying to shift from the idea of like, if I spend a dollar on this malaria paper to be open access, that's a dollar not spent on malaria research. But that's not necessarily the case in the open dissemination of information and the curation, especially of data, I think is becoming more of a core component of what funding should be used for. So having more and more of those conversations. Compromise, I think, is an interesting one. And, you know, I've been at the foundation for 6 years now working on the open access policy. And we've, you know, we had the original policy. Now we've had a new one that came out in January 1st, 2021. And really, you know, working in the nitty-gritty details of it, we've definitely made compromises along the way, because there's so many different stakeholders that we're trying to make happy and trying to prioritize, you know, what those needs and wants are and what our mission is, and making sure that our research outputs have the greatest impact. But some of that has led to compromise and can lead to sometimes very complex and confusing and nuanced policies. You know, we are aligned with Plan S, but I think that's one of them. While I think making great changes also can be quite complex, and a lot of that is due to compromises that we make. And choice is something that has come up a lot in conversations, and I'm continually thinking about is the, you know, the, what is the author's choice in all of this? What does author choice and academic freedom really mean? I mean, I would argue that it doesn't exist in the traditional system, because you don't have the freedom to read most of the research out there unless you are privileged enough to work at an institution or be connected to an institution that's able to pay those fees. and really trying to focus those conversations of academic freedom around the exploration of the research and not exactly the dissemination of it. Removal of paywall. So this is kind of transitioning into what we've seen during the pandemic. And I think if there's hopefully any, you know, silver lining in what we've experienced in the past year is learning what worked, what didn't work, and what needed to change. So we noticed at the beginning of the pandemic, a lot of paywalls were removed. For some publishers, it was very specific to certain keywords. Some of them, which I really appreciated, the publishers that are just like, look, we're taking down all our paywalls because everyone's working remotely, you know, especially for education and students now being at home, made it so much easier. So, and they saw increased use, which I think just further, you know, gives evidence to openness leading to a more use, more citations, and further impact of that research when there's no barrier to access. We also saw a lot of the increased speed. So preprints really took off in the past year, especially with the release of MedArchive and then focusing on getting COVID work out there quickly. There was, of course, you know, there's a lot of discussions around whether that's going too fast, and you know, those things aren't peer reviewed. But we also saw, you know, some issues with traditional publishers that had to end up retracting things. You know, so the harm on both sides, and trying to think about how can we mitigate for that in the future. And then also they did work on increasing some really interesting things around increasing the speed of peer review. I would like to have seen a lot more transparency in that for those publishers, so that we could see kind of the quality of that and how did that lend itself to the final output. But I think we'll get there eventually. And that leads to my next point, which is the increased need for transparency. I mean, I think especially in a pandemic and something that is such a global public health issue and affects, you know, everyone's lives, and has, I think, you know, for at least for me, first time I've seen in a long time of just the general public being really engaged and tuned into what is happening in this space and in science, that more transparency can go a long way, especially to help with against like disinformation and making sure that everyone is as informed as possible to mitigate for the effects of the pandemic. I wanted to mention quickly hybrid journals. So this is a kind of a key component of Plan S. And we do not pay for hybrid journal publications anymore. So we're trying to shift that model to one that is fully open. So hybrid journals are journals that they collect the subscription from institutions, and they also collect the open access fees for publications as well. And there's definitely a healthy discussion on whether or not publishers typically offset those costs, and it creates a phenomenon known as double dipping. Whether or not that happens, I still think there are other reasons to not support this model. The first one being it hasn't made the, you know, open access the default. So originally the idea was that the hybrid journal will be transitioned to full open access. And after about 20 years, I think, of this, we have not seen the numbers tip more towards open access. And they're often more expensive. So if we're looking at the APC level, the article processing charges, so those are the fees that we pay for open access, they're often almost twice as much as some of the full open access journals that are just open access by default. And we haven't seen a lot of evidence as to, you know, is what we're paying more for in those journals reflective of more value added? And I don't think so. So, and then they're also much more error prone. So as somebody who manages publications for our grantees, I spend the most time trying to fix errors around the hybrid journal. So we may have paid for things, they end up being paywalled anyways, often attributed a wrong license, unreliable your repository deposits, sometimes they will withhold publishing it if it hasn't been paid for yet. So it makes it stressful for the authors and policymakers, and then for the readers as well. It's unpredictable, like what article is going to be open access. You're still going to hit paywalls for other content in that article. So it's kind of a strange experience for someone who's trying to stay up to date through a journal on a specific topic. So moving on to evidence-based publishing. So this is something I've been thinking more through is I feel like, you know, we have the scientific method. We have a very specific way of researchers doing their experiments and their work. And then we have a specific way of disseminating it, but we don't seem to interrogate that dissemination method as much as we do the way that the research is conducted itself. So I think it's, you know, we have a lot of evidence that peer review isn't working well as is. And then it's quite hard to reproduce results. I'm going to talk briefly about predatory publishers and kind of my differing view on their kind of threat to the ecosystem, and then a little bit more on the pandemic response. So asking if, like, are we ignoring the evidence here? There's been a lot of interesting opinion pieces written about this recently. Some of it spurred by the pandemic, but I think it's very clear that peer review was overburdened. It's costly to, you know, various stakeholders. We see people being tapped to review a lot. There's a lot of discussions around whether or not peer reviewers should be paid. That can be a whole separate discussion. I mean, I don't think that's going to fix the problem, but I think it's an interesting thought experiment to work through and seeing, like, what are we really trying to accomplish with scholarly communications, and how do we actually support a community? I'm consistently surprised that data is rarely included in peer review, and there's been some interesting points made that peer review isn't necessarily meant to find, you know, fraud or data manipulation. Then I wonder then if it's just a gatekeeping mechanism for journal brands and kind of meeting a level of novelty that makes me very, very nervous, because I don't think that's healthy for the research itself or researchers. And peer review across the board is pretty non-transparent. So I think it's interesting that we put a lot of faith in a title and a brand of a journal and an article that's been, you know, peer reviewed by, you know, 3 to 4 people that we don't know, and we haven't seen those reports. And so there's a lot of trust there that I find very interesting. And I'm a major proponent for open peer review, and I'll talk more about that later. And then reproducibility, again, a whole other topic that's of importance, but seeing more and more evidence that a lot of studies are not reproducible, at least in how they're currently disseminated. There are a lot of great projects happening right now trying to alleviate this problem. We've made a lot of progress in the last decade with having pre-registration, the data availability, working on output management plans, all of those reporting methods. So there's a lot happening there, but I still think in kind of the or the traditional publishing sense, we're missing a lot of those pieces in studies that are published. And there's really no incentive to get it fundamentally right. And we can see that through some of the retractions that happen. I highly recommend following Retraction Watch if you're interested in how, you know, research is corrected right now and kind of what are the issues that come out post-publication. Predatory publishers. So this comes up a lot in both, in scholarly communication and library discussions often. Many, you know, do think it's a major issue that we need to address. I feel it's more of a distraction of away from what we, you know, really need to focus on, big picture of kind of what is the future of academic publishing. There's a lot of research that shows that most publications in so-called predatory journals are rarely read or cited. So I don't know how far that information is getting out to do damage. We also don't have a lot of insight into kind of the quality. Is everything coming out of here, you know, incorrect science, or is it just not a very good or well-sourced journal? There's really no set definition of what a predatory publisher is. In the history of this, it was a librarian named Beale who was kind of collecting a list, and there was a lot of problems with having, I think, one person set that definition. It also can be very exclusory to publishers that are in low-income countries or areas or publishers that are just getting started. So in order to kind of come into the scholarly communication space as a journal, it can be quite hard to get indexed in certain things, and you have to have, you know, a certain amount of publications to even get going. So labeling a journal that's starting out predatory could essentially squash them from ever being, you know, competitive in the space. And I see some very interesting pieces lately about how I linked it in the slide deck that a researcher who in philosophy decided that he's only going to publish in these type of journals and lists out very, I think, compelling reasons why. And a lot of that is because there's less of a barrier to entry into these journals when he just wants to get his research out there. Didn't find that typically the peer review is that terrible compared to his experiences in the reputable journals. You know, there's not as much gatekeeping and no real, you know, restrictions on word count. And kind of, I think some of these predatory, so-called predatory publishers are less stringent on kind of retaining certain elements from the print era. So I find that really, really compelling. And there's also another great piece that I should have included about how even large reputable publishers can have quite what I think most of us would consider predatory practices in trying to, you know, get you to submit and kind of that the spam in your, you know, email box for supplements and special issues and the way some publishers, for example, will charge extra if you want to have your cover image included in their journal. So I think it's you know, this can be very hard to define. And I think really what we should be focused on is how do we make the system better for everyone and not focus so much on, you know, calling a section of publishers predatory or not, and also just really focusing on the research itself. I really like this quote from Cameron Nalin. You know, if we think of openness of communication is valuable in a crisis, it should surely be valuable in normal times as well. So this is something I think especially funders are thinking a lot more about now, is seeing how collaboration and openness really helped us get to interventions and a vaccine quite quickly compared to other times. So why can't we replicate that for climate change or Alzheimer's? There's, you know, and rare diseases, there's so many issues out there that I think would really benefit from a change of this system. And so addressing a lot of these issues is going to go a long way in getting us there. Next, I'm going to talk a little bit about copyright, and that it ties in with, you know, openness and kind of the reuse of the research. So who really has the rights? And I feel like I've become a de facto a lawyer on copyright in the past few years of really working on this. And I think it's quite fascinating. So there's open licenses, so there's the Creative Commons licenses, and there's a range of them that you can, you know, attribute to your article to have different restrictions around reuse. Authors retain their copyright. I see a lot of major publishers are pushing for more restrictive licensing. So for our policy, we've always required the CC BY license, which is close to the most liberal besides public domain, but essentially it can be reused for commercial purposes or not. The only thing that's required is attribution. And I think, you know, this is not a popular opinion, but in seeing kind of how the open access system works right now, you essentially have to pay the publisher to release your copyright and work, to keep your copyright. So they're kind of holding a hostage until you pay a certain amount of money to make it a Creative Commons license. Typically, you would sign over rights to the publisher, and that can mean various things depending on what you agree to. But essentially, it makes it so that no one can build upon or use parts of that research without having permission from the publisher, and oftentimes that could come with fees. So if they wanted to reuse a figure from one of your papers, they would need the publisher's blessing, and then also probably have to pay for that as well. And so that kind of gets into like who owns what and who's kind of adding the value to it. So, research is funded by private and taxpayer dollars. So that's why it's important for us to make sure that there's as much reuse ability as possible. Yeah, the kind of estimate of like peer review and volunteer time, that's given to the publishers, I think is a topic of consideration that again is going through a lot of discussion. Especially with, should we pay for peer review or who would pay for it? Should publishers pay for it? Is it part of, being part of the community or being part of an institution that pays for your salary? So lots of interesting things to unpack there and how it intersects with copyright and the value add. I'll talk a little bit more about the rights retention strategy in the next slide. And then, yeah, I've already mentioned kind of I feel like the way the system is right now, that copyright is held hostage until you pay, and some publishers charge even more for the more liberal licenses. So the rights retention strategy is something that was created by the Coalition S, and it's something that we have adopted at the foundation. We actually changed our grant agreement to protect the rights of our grantees. So the open access policy statement in the grant agreement provides sufficient copyright for grantees to make a version of their manuscript open access. And typically we're talking about the author accepted manuscript. So it's gone through peer review and in the final author edits, but it is not the final typeset, copy edited, or branded by the journal, or typically known as the version of record. And so this was a big change for us. Typically, our policy was basically a pay to make open access, and that's it. So if the journal, and in some cases, it's the considered high impact journals of science and nature, don't allow for any open access. So that made those journals non-compliant, and then we had to really consider the effects that that had on the careers of our grantees. So while we're trying to change the incentive system, it's not going to happen overnight, and we're trying to be cognizant of people who get kind of stuck in the transition. So this rights retention strategy allows for any journal to become compliant. So we're not relying on the policies of the publishers anymore, but stating that, like, hey, we have, our grantees have a right to make a version of their article open access. Of course, most of the publishers have not found this to be a great strategy. We also don't, I mean, I should clarify that funders, we don't believe this is a sustainable and the best solution for this, but really it's a forcing mechanism to try to find better models to have full open access. So it's definitely a workaround for the time being. It's opened up conversations with publishers that we've never had before, which is great. It's definitely, I think, pushing the conversation forward more quickly than it would have if we didn't have a strategy and stayed with our original kind of pay for open access policy. It's interesting to see that some publishers are trying to change their kind of systems and workflows so that, this isn't needed, but in such a way that instead of, they're going to make somebody pay. And so we're watching this space, and we're cognizant of kind of the thorny issues within this, but sticking to the fundamental approach of this and why we're doing it to ensure that there's at least some output for of a research is open access. And then I can't help but wonder, kind of, publishers talk a lot about author choice and if they're now being funneled through one route of publication, that's not exactly our intended outcome. So watching that as well. All right, so enough of all of the kind of pain points and how I frame them and see them. But let's start talking more about solutions and the remedies. So I'm going to talk a little bit about new models and share the Gates Open Research Experience, which I think is really fantastic. I really want to delve into more community and how do we keep growing our communities and connecting them and collaborating with them more, and then touch on libraries as well. So this is Gates Open Research. We've launched it in 2017. It's built on the F1000 technology, but so this is a kind of a Gates branded version of that. But really, the reason why we launched this was because we really believe that the model is kind of the future of publishing. I think it best leverages the technology that's available to us and can scale in the future, but it's a fully open post-publication peer-reviewed system. And I think it eliminates a lot of the pain points that we see in the traditional system. It's also fully version controlled, which I think is really important. The model kind of marries preprints with the traditional system. So it's hosted within 7 days after it goes through initial editorial check. So then anyone can read it and cite it or comment on it. And then it starts going through peer review and you can see that process as it goes, but it can't be submitted to another journal, which I think is great because it gets rid of kind of this journal shopping that we see and just gets the information out there and assessed. And I think with the full versioning, it makes the process more of a conversation between the peer reviewers that the reader can partake in and see and really evaluate the research itself and not more of a gatekeeping mechanism. So those are what I think are the important points here. And just to give you kind of a quick look at what that looks like, we have the article submission. They're very great at keeping the data attached to it, and then it goes through the open peer review and has the, you know, all the metrics and information, great metadata. And then once it passes peer review, that's when it gets kind of indexed and it's the official kind of version of record, even though versions can be done at any time. And we've seen some authors, you know, a year or two after the first publication, instead of creating a whole new publication record, they'll just make a new version to provide an update, which is especially great with like micro publications or data notes. So it's just a much more agile process. And here's what the peer review looks like. There we go. So there's a rating system, a check is approved, question mark is approved with reservations, and then there's a not approved. And we have things that have not been approved. They kind of just live on the system, and it's up to the authors to address the peer reviewers' concerns. If they don't, then it doesn't end up getting indexed, so it's not more widely disseminated. But there's an option for them to improve upon it, and that also then can't be taken to another journal and published somewhere where you don't see that it didn't really address these concerns. And I've seen that these reports are pretty comprehensive. They're very focused on the research, very helpful. They can be critical, but also not, I think, you know, we can see a lot of bullying within peer review when it's non-transparent. I think adding the transparency, putting multiple names so everyone can get credit to it, you can cite this report, I think it really elevates the conversation. So the minimal requirements for indexing is two checks, or a check and two question marks. And again, we've also seen people, you know, continually improving on their versions until they have full support. So moving on to the community. So I've been thinking a lot about, you know, picking partnerships that actually match mission and values. And I think that's going to be more of a conversation in the years to come. So we have many different organizations that are already making this happen. And I think oftentimes we can get kind of stuck on, you know, what are the big five publishers doing? Of course, they have a lot of power in this space, but there are also a lot of great community-led changes happening, and I think we should elevate those. I'm very excited about the subscribe to open model. So that's a model that basically removes paywalls and makes everything open access with the community support. So libraries, you know, as they traditionally would subscribe to be able to get around a paywall, instead they're subscribing to make that content open to all the community. So there's interesting things there. It's very similar to kind of a PLOS community action. So they're realizing that, you know, article processing charges are creating a barrier for entry to publish instead of, you know, a barrier to read. And so they're trying to tackle that. I really like the Journal of Open Source Software. They, I think, use a really fantastic model that keeps their costs very, very low, and they're very agile and signed in with tech. PeerJ is another great one. So these are just some examples of new players in the space that are really trying to innovate, or like Cielo has a great following in Latin America, and they've really made open access the norm for those researchers in a way that we haven't seen in the US or the more westernized states. So I think there's a lot to be learned from there. And I love this tweet and just had to share it. So I have a lot of conversations on like, how do we get to the future of open access? And I think it's really important to consider that it has been done for some publishers, some disciplines, and we should be able to learn from that and replicate what works, riff off of what didn't. And so I loved, this just pointing out this journal that if it's really a priority to the publisher and the publisher and the community, built around that publisher, then they're going to make it happen. And same with libraries. I mean, I think libraries are key in this. From a funder perspective, I've been wanting to work more closely with libraries. I think, we now have funders in the space paying for a lot of knowledge dissemination. It's been something libraries have done for a very long time. So how can we coordinate those efforts to get to the future that we want to see? So I want to work more closely with libraries in the next few years in ways that we haven't before as a funder. I'm seeing a lot of discussion around libraries being value driven and some of the frameworks for that. So, when you're picking your collection development and your vendor relationships, like aside from just having access to the content, are we picking partners that reflect our values and are good partners in this space? And so, again, a lot of change coming up. I think with budgets are consistently becoming tighter, and COVID is not going to make that better. I think we have to make some tough choices, but if we can have them being driven by values, that'll go a long way. And then again, that topic of choice, libraries, I think often feel like they can have no power into who they partner with and having to have access to certain things. But I think I see that shifting as well. And they want to shift away from kind of being renters of the information to the lenders that they, traditionally in print form have been, and really helping their community get access to great information. At any time, like I think during the pandemic, it's been really interesting to see how the ebook pricing discussion has really highlighted this need. All right, and the last topic, so I want to make sure we have time for questions. Going to touch on two things briefly around data. So, it's great publications and knowledge dissemination, very, very important, but the data is really where a lot of that continued research and building upon research can happen. So we've been doing some deep dive work around our underlying data policy that we've had for the open access policy. What does that look like? And we have a lot of pain points around data. I think as a foundation, we're a bit behind in our strategy, but it's great that we have a lot of leaders to learn from. We're starting kind of small, but I think that's good, because if we get these things right, then we'll be able to scale up more at an enterprise level of how we really tackle data. I think there was always been an assumption that it's not really the foundation's place to work with our grantees around data sharing, or that we shouldn't manage any of the data ourselves, but that's really shifted in the past 5 years. And we kind of checked our assumptions that it isn't easy for everyone, or not everyone has the resources to be able to share data, and that we've been doing it so far downstream to, underlying to a publication, that it's more time, money, and effort to try to make that data available than if we really really were intentional in the beginning and built it into the entire process. So we're starting with some principles to help shape this discussion, especially get leadership involved around how we can use their voice and advocacy, and have the principles kind of shape the rest of the work that follows. There's a really, one of the biggest concerns around data sharing, whether it's open or even managed, is privacy preservation. So we formed a community of practice for that. And that work is taking off. We've learned a lot of different ways to be able to share data safely while still protecting privacy. And then the third piece that I'm most excited about is piloting an output management plan. So we have typically not required these. It can depend on the program team, or the grant, some of them, you know, do, but it's very kind of piecemeal and who understands that work requires it and its impact. So we're trying to be more intentional about it and have a specific, you know, pilot for a bunch of our different grants and see how that goes and kind of what is the guidance and support that's needed in that, and also how much, you know, funding will it take to make this happen, because I think that's going to be a critical component as well, as actually funding the infrastructure and training and supports and making sure that we're not just putting policies out there and having people try to figure them out themselves and how to make them happen. And the last piece I wanted to share, so I'm really excited about this project and something that we've been funding for a while off and on now, but is a creation of lens.org, which is kind of an open knowledge database. It combines the kind of typical citation databases with patents as well, but they've done a lot of amazing work in the past year around building kind of these profiles and you kind of have your workspace so you can do your analyses. I use it primarily for literature reviews, which makes it very easy for me to conduct those for program staff and provide the information that they need. It highlights open access information. It's really looking to be a competitor to, say, the Scopus or Web of Sciences functionality, which can be quite costly for libraries. So they're trying a different model. So I just wanted to share that as a great resource to experiment with and see what you think about it. And I will stop there and thank you and happy to answer any questions.
Yeah, so Ashley, thank you so much for that comprehensive presentation. And you do have a couple of questions in the chat.
Great.
Doreen Nesdell is asking, do the articles in the Gates Open Research link out to data, code, et cetera?
Yes, they do. And the editorial team does a great job of ensuring that. And I'm actually, one of the things that's changed in our policy guidance this year is we are requiring data availability statements for every publication, because that's something that's not widely required, but will help us at least be able to point to data if it can't be shared. And Gates Open Research does a great job of like either linking to a repository, or if there is a reason, for example, we work with a lot of government data and that can easily be shared, and definitely not openly, but it would at least detail where you could go to request access to such information. And we're always looking at ways of improving that, like partnerships with like protocols.io, so that there's, you know, also a link to methods and protocols. There's great linkages there. And we actually found when we tried to do a compliance report of our underlying data policy, grantees that published in really, if they published in journals that really embraced open science practices, they were much more successful in sharing their data and sharing it well than in other journals.
Looks like there is a request for your contact info to go back up.
Yes.
That I did send out the slide deck and it was attached to the invite, so everybody might have access to it, but I'll make sure that
And I'm happy. Yep.
And then there's a question from Jake Carlson about, what roles, if any, do you see for institutional repository and data institutional repository in this evolving landscape of open research?
Yeah, I think it's going to become even more critical. And this is something funders are talking a lot more about. So I think in the past, especially at the foundation, we've had very much this, we want to do this thing and we're going to also throw in a bunch of money to make like a data repository to go with it. And we wouldn't have necessarily the expertise or the marketing for that data repository. So it ended up oftentimes not being used. And so now I'm trying to encourage, instead of trying to rebuild things ourselves, we really tap into institutional repositories and knowledge there. And that's one of the ways too I'd like to be able to work more closely with libraries, because the discussions that we've had around data management and sharing, everyone's like, well, you know, then we need to like hire technical assistance. And I'm like, or we could really tap into the resources that many institutions already have and then If there are any gaps, we could help there. But I think repositories at libraries for both publications and then now moving more into data are really critical of, you know, ensuring long-term access to this. I mean, yes, I'm a proponent of having multiple versions out everywhere in the world, not just at a single site, because I don't think that's good for posterity. So I see a lot of opportunity for institutional repositories to continue to grow and scale. And I think, you know, funders should definitely be more aware of those projects and what's happening there, so that you know, we don't duplicate things that we don't need to duplicate. And I think we should be encouraging grantees to use resources at their institutions.
Yeah, I'm not seeing any other questions. Does anybody have any question or want to unmute and ask a question as well? Even we're kind of a small group. There was a shout out, I believe, for the lens.org.
I love that thing. Yeah, that's great.
Well, otherwise, if there aren't any more questions, we really appreciate your time today and sharing this information with us. And like I said, I will be making the recording available through our institutional repository. So
great.
Making use of that tool to be able to share this content. And yeah, and we really, again, appreciate the time. And if anybody has any questions, they can get directly in touch with you through the contact information that you've provided.
Yes, yes, please, please do. Thank you. Thanks. And hey, Natalie.
Hi, thanks for a great presentation.
Thank you.